Hi everyone, welcome to this video about cross-compilation for ARM using a regular x86-based PC running Debian or Ubuntu. The ARM architecture is gaining a lot of traction in the market currently, but a lot of these Linux-based ARM devices are quite limited in resources. So if you find yourself missing a tool or a program on your embedded device or NAS or switch or router, it's quite difficult to build it on the platform itself. And this limitation is not only because of a lack of compute resources, but often these devices are running a custom-built Linux, missing libraries and build tools. By using cross-compilation, which is the ability to build on one platform something that we can use on another platform or architecture, we can still build tools for it. For example, on your regular PC, which is probably x86-based, you could build something for 32 or 64-bit ARM, for example, a Raspberry Pi. In this video, I'll try to explain you how you can accomplish this in practice using Debian or Ubuntu. Before we get started, I'd like to point out that I also have a blog, jensd.be. Over there, you can find all information that I will share in this video in detail, so if you plan to go through this process yourself, I really recommend you to have a look there. Personally, from time to time, I use cross-compilation if I'm lacking tools on such device like I mentioned in the beginning. Together with static linking, which I will also explain in the video, I end up with a very portable file, which is easy to use on those devices. Let's first start by having a look at the theoretical background for cross-compilation. For a regular compilation, build and host architecture are the same. This situation, the most common, is called native. We have a certain source code for a tool or program which we want to compile and the necessary dependencies or dev libraries. Next, we have the compiler suited for that same architecture. If we prepare, then run the code through that compiler, we end up with a binary for, surprise surprise, that same architecture. That binary, if all went well, should execute just fine on the same machine. Now, when we look at cross-compilation, the build and host architecture are different. Here, the build platform is a regular PC, x86-64, and the host is 64-bit ARM. The goal is that the build platform generates a binary that is able to execute on the host platform. Again, we need the source code and necessary dependencies, but this time we need to use a compiler that is suited to run on our build architecture, but is able to generate binaries that are executable on the host architecture. The result of executing the cross-compilation is another binary. This time it cannot be executed on the build machine, but as we desired, after copying it to a machine that is on the host architecture, it runs just fine over there. First, something quick about 32 and 64-bit ARM. During the video, I will mention this a few times, and which to choose completely depends on what device you are building or compiling for. To find out the architecture, you can run uname-m. For example, on the PC that will be the build machine, or on a 32-bit ARM-based device, and the output on a 64-bit ARM-based device. Let's have a look now at how we can get this to work in practice. So for this video, I'm using Debian 10, but I also tested the exact same commands on a Ubuntu server install. To make sure you can replicate this setup without worrying about any prerequisite steps, I started in both cases with a minimal install. To be able to go through this, we need to start by installing the required tools. We need GCC and a cross-compiler for the host architecture, 32 or 64-bit, binaries for the same, and make to be able to handle larger projects. Just to start small, I will compile a very minimal Hello World example in C. I'll just create the source file and save it as helloworld.c. Then I can do a simple native compilation by passing that file to GCC. The result is a binary built for the same machine as where I ran this command, x86-64. Which also means we should be able to run it here, and that works just fine as we expect. So far, I hope you're still following. So now let's repeat the previous command and do a cross-compilation for 32-bit ARM. We can repeat the same, but for 64-bit ARM. And as you can see in the file output, we can clearly see a difference between all three binaries. When trying to execute one that was compiled for ARM on this machine, as we would expect, we get an error. Now, if we move this binary to another machine, for example, this one, which is on 64 bit ARM, we can see that the binary does exactly what we'd expect. First cross-compilation is a success. That first example went pretty well, but let's say you want to build something from a real project, which you typically start by running a configure script, and then you run make to do the actual compilation, as this project would consist of several files that need to be ran through the compiler. Fortunately, this is not very different, as the change for cross-compilation would be to use the right compiler again. As an example, I will compile strace, which is often missing on limited ARM devices, but really handy to troubleshoot misbehaving applications. As with the first Hello World example, we need to get the source first. We can download this directly from GitHub and extract the files. Now we need to run configure, but to do the cross-compilation, we can simply pass the build and host platform architectures to it. I also choose here to do static linking, on which I will elaborate in a bit. Once the configure script completed, we can run make to do the actual cross-compilation. Looking at the headers of the binary, we can see this is built for 64-bit ARM, as desired. In case you want to do the same but for 32-bit ARM, you can simply replace the host parameter which we passed to the configure script. Now, as with the small C program, let's get this over to an ARM-based device and test if it's working. As you can see, this works just fine, and by copying this single file, due to the static linking, that's all we need to be able to execute strace. As I mentioned in the beginning, I mainly use cross-compilation to build troubleshooting tools. This is mostly for platforms that lack pre-built packages or it's not possible to install them. This means that, even when you would have a regular dynamically linked binary, there is a very good chance that you miss some of the dependencies or, even if they are present, they are outdated or conflicting. That being said, let me elaborate a bit more about static linking. In a normal situation, when a program is dynamically linked, the binary contains program-specific code and the data required specifically for that program. Any dependencies are external and managed or compiled separately. The program code can just access them when needed. The second program, Y here, can use the same dependencies. Now when we look at the program that is statically linked, Z, during build or link time, we actually include the dependencies in the binary. Obviously, as you can see right away, this generates larger binaries. And another advantage of dynamic linking is that if we upgrade one of those dependencies to a new version, we do not need to recompile X or Y. That is, of course, if it remains compatible. All tools that use that dependency will take immediate benefit of the improvements or fixes in that new version. The static link program, on the other hand, will keep using the older, bundled version. The large advantage of static linking, though, is that if one of those dependencies is missing on the system, all is still working. Hence why, for my use case and to ensure portability, static linking is a nice choice. Unfortunately, it's not always easy to perform static linking. Most tools, in some way at least, depend on libc or glibc, and because of the way this has dependencies on its own, this causes issues. Fortunately, there is a libc implementation that was developed from scratch and that allows proper static linking for libc dependencies, MUSL. The easiest way to make use of MUSL is to download the correct version for your cross-compilation. Now to give an example, I'll use MUSL to build a statically linked version for 64-bit ARM of tcpdump. tcpdump is a very useful tool to capture incoming and outgoing network traffic, a must for troubleshooting if you ask me. The scripts that are bundled with the source of tcpdump use some tools, Flex and Bison, so we need to install these first. Then, we can download the source for libpcap and tcpdump and extract them. After downloading and extracting the source code, we need to run the configure script for libpcap first. Only this time, we need to set our compiler to the muscle compiler by setting the CC variable correctly. If all went fine, we can do the actual compilation of libpcap by issuing make. Next, we need to repeat both steps for TCP dump as well. Again, provide muscle by setting CC to the right value. By doing the static linking, libpcap will be included, and the result should be a single binary TCP dump. So for the third time, let's copy this resulting file to our 64-bit ARM device and see if that works. The ARM device has a web server that is listening on port 9000, so we should see the traffic it receives if you try to query it. As you can see, TCP dump worked just fine and didn't need any dependencies. This is really helpful if you need to work or troubleshoot on platforms that come with a very limited set of tools and no ability to easily install them. You can simply copy the file and it will work.
Thanks a lot for watching. I really hope you liked the video, and if you did, please put a thumbs up. If you like this and similar content, don't hesitate to subscribe to my channel. Like I mentioned in the beginning, I also have a blog, jens.be, where you can find all information that I shared here in detail. Thanks again, and I really hope to see you back here soon.